If you're given a ball, a tire, and a flat screen television and asked to mark the center of mass, you will be able to do it quite quickly. In fact, if you throw the ball as a projectile, you can even predict how the center of mass of the ball would move. That is, it would move quite the way a point mass would, following a parabolic path. And you could tell all this simply because the ball is a symmetrical object and it is easy to identify its center of mass. But now if you flip a baseball bat into the air, you'll realize its motion is quite erratic, primarily because every particle of the bat moves in a different path. And these paths can make various shapes that are definitely not parabolic. So by no chance can we describe the bat as a point mass the way we could describe the ball. Rather, it is a system of particles, each of which follows its own path through the air. But you see, the bat has one special point that we call the center of mass that does move in an elegant parabolic arc, just like a ball. And the other particles of the bat move around this center of mass. You can in fact locate the bat's center of mass by balancing it on a finger, and the point would be right above your finger along the bat's central axis. Now, here, since the bat is moving under the force of gravity or an external force, you got a parabolic path. But if you had spun the bat on a long horizontal table where the net force on the bat is zero, the center of mass would have moved along a straight line. So you see, if we can define the center of mass of a system of particles like this bat, we can actually predict the possible motion of the system by assuming the mass is concentrated at the center of mass, quite like a ball or a symmetrical object. And then we can say that this center of mass is the point that moves as if, one, all of the system's mass were concentrated there, and two, all external forces were applied to that point. So here we could say that while the force of gravity is acting on every particle of this bat, we can simplify our calculations by assuming that the entire force of gravity is acting through this point. So now let us get a little mathematical about how we can find the location of the center of mass of a system of particles. So let us start with a system of only few particles, and then we will move on to a system that has many particles and finally to solid bodies. So let us take these two masses, MA and MB, such that MA is at XA and MB is at XB. Then the way we find the center of mass of this system is by multiplying mass A with its distance from the origin, that is XA, plus mass of B multiplied by its distance from the origin, that is XB, and then dividing it by the total mass MA plus MB. So here you have your center of mass of this system. So now let us say that MB is equal to 0, that is, we are left with MA only, and we therefore know that the center of mass should now lie at the position of MA, simply because your system is now mass A only. And when we put mass B is equal to 0 in this equation, we find that indeed the center of mass becomes XA, that is, position of mass A. Now let us say that we make mass A equal to mass B, then just looking at the symmetry, we can say that the center of mass should be at the middle of the two particles. And when we make mass A is equal to mass B in this equation, what we find is center of mass becomes XA plus XB upon 2, which is indeed midway between the two points. And finally, this equation also tells us that if both MA and MB are greater than 0, center of mass will necessarily lie between XA and XB, or between the two particles. Okay, now what if we make MB significantly larger than MA? Well, we should expect the center of mass to move quite a bit towards mass B, and likewise if you made MA much larger than MB, the center of mass should move towards MA. Now, let us introduce another particle MC at XC. Then we can find the center of mass of this setup by simply adding MC, XC in the numerator and adding MC in the denominator. And then this formula will give us the position of center of mass for these three masses. So you see here how introduction of third mass moved center of mass in this direction. Well, in real life, you could have been given a setup where there are three people of roughly equal mass, say 60 kilograms, sitting on a light piece of log, and their positions are, let's say, XA is equal to 2 meters, XB is equal to 10, and XC is equal to 12. And we are asked to find the center of mass of the setup, assuming the log's mass can be ignored. Then we can use this formula right away and put the values in respective places to find the location of the center of mass that would be 8 meters. In other words, if this setup was balanced at this point, it would be stable and not tip in either direction. So you see, this example demonstrates how the concept of center of mass helps in solving real-world problems by simplifying complex systems into more manageable calculations. So, if we were to write a more general equation for a system of n particles instead of 3 particles, and these particles are spread across the x-axis, then the location of center of mass would be x center of mass is equal to m1 x1 plus m2 x2 plus m3 x3 plus all the way up to the last mass n into xn, divide by m1 plus m2 plus m3 right up to mn, or the total mass. Or if we say m is equal to m1 plus m2 plus m3 right up to mn, then the location of the center of mass in shorthand can be written as 1 upon m sigma mi xi as I changes from 1 to n. And the subscript I basically is an index that takes on all integer values from 1 to n so that all products of various masses with their distances from the origin are included. Now, if the particles are distributed in three-dimensional space, it makes sense that the center of mass must be represented by three coordinates, that is x, y, and z. Well, to establish y and z coordinates, we can use the same equation but replace x with y or z. So the x, y, z coordinates of center of mass of n particles would be: x center of mass is what we just showed earlier, y center of mass would become 1 upon m sigma mi yi as I changes from 1 to n. That is, now instead of taking the x values, here we take the y coordinates of each particle. And likewise, z center of mass would be 1 upon m sigma mi zi. So let us now say that we introduce mass C here. Then what we find is that the center of mass is no more defined by the x coordinates only, but also by y coordinates. And you can see that the new center of mass has moved to this point above the x-axis. In fact, SimBucket has a very interesting simulation that shows how the center of mass moves as the distribution of mass changes. So you see here, the center of mass is along the x-axis as you add mass along the x-axis. But the moment you add mass along the y-axis, the center of mass moves above the x-axis, and if you continue to add more mass along the y-axis, the center of mass keeps moving up. Now, sometimes when solving problems, you can make the calculations easier for yourself by choosing the coordinate system in a way that one of the masses sits at the origin. So let us say we decide on a coordinate system, in this case where mass A sits at x is equal to 0, so xA becomes 0. And then you see finding the center of mass becomes easier since this term and this vanish, making the calculation simpler. So you can decide the coordinate system to make your calculation easier. However, once this coordinate system is chosen, you should be consistent in using throughout the problem. And note that in spite of the shift of the coordinate system, the center of the mass is still the same distance from each particle. So you see, the center of mass is a property of the physical particles, not the coordinate system we choose. So this playlist covers a range of related topics, including linear momentum and its conservation, what is elastic collision, what is inelastic collision, and a lot of other stuff which is quite comprehensive. So do check it out. And if you like this lesson, do give it a thumbs up, and I'll see you in the next lesson.